has been such a powerful ally for game developers to get their games off the ground. New York's own Anya Combs is here to give you a rundown of the basics.
All right. Hello, everyone. My name is Anya. I am the director of games at Kickstarter. I want to thank Dan and everyone at PlayNYC for inviting me to chat with you today about Kickstarter. I know we have a little bit of limited time, so I'm going to do my best to get through Kickstarter 101 as quickly as I can. So as I said in the beginning, my name is Anya. I am the director of games at Kickstarter. I've been in games actually 12 years. This is my 12th year in games. I'm the former developer relations person at Addicting Games. I've also worked at Nickelodeon in mobile and content development and a whole host of other weird, fun projects in games. So what is Kickstarter? So Kickstarter's mission is to bring creative projects to life. We do that by connecting people to the projects that they love, and we do that better than anyone. At least we like to think that we do. People from nearly every country on Earth have backed a project on Kickstarter. It's important to note that our community actually represents nearly every country and all seven continents. And yes, that does actually include Antarctica. So just to quickly look at some numbers on Kickstarter, we do have the largest and most engaged funding community. There are 18.2 million people that have backed a Kickstarter project. Of that 18.2 million, about 6 million have backed more than one project. So it's safe to say that if you come to Kickstarter and back a project, the likelihood of backing another project is pretty high. Thanks to those 18.2 million people, 63.7 million pledges have been made to all projects. I do want to quickly note, these numbers represent the entire ecosystem of Kickstarter. So this is every single category, all 15 categories. This includes music, arts, dance, theater, film, everything that's currently on Kickstarter. We'll kind of dive into the games category specifically, but keep these numbers in mind, and specifically keep these numbers in mind, which is Kickstarter backers have already pledged $5.1 billion in the 11-year life cycle that Kickstarter has existed, which has helped fund over 185,000 creative projects, which is pretty cool. I do want to also note that the success rate for Kickstarter is 37.8%. These success rates are really interesting to me, and we'll dive into them a little bit more once we sort of look at the games category. So the games category, right? Games category as a whole. This includes anything that's like a card game, a video game, a VR game, a tabletop game, a miniatures game, a LARP, anything that's a game on Kickstarter. This is what this encompasses. So $1.3 billion have been pledged to the games category as a whole, 21,900 successfully funded projects with 3.9 million backers in total. Now, keeping in mind that the success rate for Kickstarter as a whole is 37.8, the games success rate is 41.3%, which is kind of cool. Just to give you a little bit of context here, that 41.3% success rate, last year in 2019, the games category success rate was 52.8%. And this year, even in a global pandemic, is 57.2%. So while we don't necessarily like to look at things from like a video games versus a tabletop perspective, it is important to note that the two categories do sometimes have different needs. And the video games category specifically, just to like put a little bit of context behind the numbers, $261 million pledged. Of that $261 million, $225 million has been raised. That's helped fund over 3,200 successful projects. It's actually a little bit more. It's a little bit closer to like 3,300, but split the difference here. And the of that 3.1 million backers that we looked at the entirety of the games category, 3.9 million, 1.8 of those are specifically to video games. There's also this really interesting 22.1% success rate. I never want this success rate to scare people because the success rate last year in 2019 was 26.5%, and this year in 2020 is actually 28%. I do also want to point out that this year, earlier this year, we had three different projects in the video games category that all made over $1 million. So while you might hear like video games are dead on Kickstarter and all of this sort of like strange information, it's simply not the case, but I would say that there's a different sort of set of rules when it comes to video games. I would also note that for every quote failure on Kickstarter, there's actually a lot more successes, right? So we have things like Divinity Original Sin, we have Wonder Song, We have Wonderville, which while technically that was an event space, it still sort of like encompasses the video games category. And we're actually going to look at a couple of successful projects that were funded in New York. But of course, we do need to talk about Tabletop Games, which is extremely successful on Kickstarter. $958 million pledged. Of that, $916 million was raised. 14,600 successful projects, which is extremely exciting. And 2.1 million backers just to Tabletop Games. That success rate is also pretty high. Again, that success rate is for the 11 years of Kickstarter. But keep in mind, in 2019 alone, 66.9% was the success rate. And this year, it's actually 70.2%, which is like pretty wild. So we've looked at all the numbers and we've, you know, you might be thinking to yourself, wow, that's kind of a lot of information. What actually makes a successful Kickstarter project? And I kind of like to look at this in two different ways. I like to look at this more of like a yeses and a nos. So this is a list of yes, and I'll explain kind of what all of this means. So yes to gameplay. Gameplay is absolutely key here. You need at least 30 seconds of gameplay to be able to show on your project page. This is extremely important. If you do not have 30 seconds of gameplay, I would not advise you launching a Kickstarter project. You also want to keep your video short, right? So your video should be like 2-3 minutes at the absolute most in length. So what we typically recommend is show 30 seconds of gameplay, 30 seconds of who you are, 30 seconds of why you're coming to Kickstarter, and then close with 30 additional seconds of gameplay. That 30 seconds of gameplay is also important because it allows you to create GIFs that you can scatter throughout your page, right? So not only should you have the necessary like text information, images, things like that, but you also need to have gameplay GIFs to kind of show like, hey, this is what the project is. The third point here, community building. I feel like I could talk about this for hours. Community building sometimes is sort of the heart and soul of Kickstarter. So, and we'll look at some projects to kind of explain what's going on the back end of things. But just to kind of parse this down a little bit, first-time creators typically see a little bit of a split here. So about 30% of your projects will come in through Kickstarter. That also does include any sort of like promotion or any sort of like features that Kickstarter is able to provide, right? So there's this misperception that you get this feature on Kickstarter, you get that Projects We Love badge, you get that homepage placement, and suddenly this insurge of pledges comes in. And while that's, you know, it's certainly helpful, it doesn't necessarily mean that it's going to bring in so many pledges that it's going to just push you over the edge and, you know, get you that $1 million sort of accolade. The reality here is, in contrast to that 30%, the 70%, which is the community that you're able to bring in. So that's through places like social media. For Tabletop Games, part of that is being on Board Game Geek. For video games, a lot of that is having a Discord and being sort of, you know, part of that Discord community. It's in addition to things like Twitter, Facebook, Reddit, if it's something that, you know, that's kind of where your community exists. But also two other big things that people forget about is friends and family, but more importantly, mailing lists. Mailing lists alone we've seen have bring in like a pretty significant amount of pledges to projects, at least, you know, sometimes it can. So doing that community building early and often, we recommend 3 to 6 months before you launch. That's when your community building should really be taking place. The fourth point here, your main project image. So that main project image that's shown right before your video on the top of the page, that main project image should really show and encompass kind of what the game is about. So if it's concept art, that's fine, but I think you should look at it a little bit more from terms of like what exactly is the game that we're trying to make. I would also note that that main project image, you should try to avoid having it as cluttered as much as you possibly can. So what I mean by that is I see people put like the little icons for like the consoles that they're coming out on. For Tabletop Games, it's a lot of like EU friendly with, you know, badges and things like that. The most egregious ones that we see are things like funded in 24 hours, funded in 72 hours, now live on Kickstarter. I understand wanting to have those like pillars of success and those milestones, but we encourage you to really put those into the actual project page versus the main image. Again, your main image should be representative of what your project is and not the accolades that kind of come with running a project. Be honest. So there's sort of this trope in video games, right? And I am speaking be honest kind of specifically to video games, although obviously this does apply to tabletop games too. But the be honest portion that we're, you know, pretty pretty aggressive about is pretty straightforward. Development delays happen, right? So if we're looking at, you know, one of the biggest titles to come out in 2019, Untitled Goose Game, they were actually delayed. Cyberpunk also just announced a couple weeks ago, days, time is meaningless. They announced that they're also going to be delayed. So delays happen. It's totally okay. It's totally fine. It genuinely is okay as long as you communicate to your backers. I also understand not necessarily wanting to provide, like, or being scared to kind of deliver bad news, but having news delivered in a way that's just kind of laying the facts out is so much better than lying or not providing the information. In the tabletop space, this kind of comes down to potentially like shipping delays, custom delays, things like that. Again, as long as you're honest with your backers, you're setting yourself up for so much success. And lastly, the 30 to 35 day sort of caveat. So we get a lot of questions about this, like how long should my project last? And we've done a bit of research on this, and we found that 30 to 35 days is just sort of the perfect time frame, right? So anything that's less than 30 days tends to be a little bit too little, and anything that's over 35 days tends to be a little bit too much. There's something about that 30 to 35 day period that people are completely comfortable with funding a Kickstarter in. So we looked at the list of yeses. Let's look at the list of nos. So the first big no is not having a video. You just need to have a video. That doesn't mean that you need to be in the video. That doesn't mean it needs to be this big cinematic experience. You can do a lot of things with an iPhone these days or just any sort of mobile device that you have. Even just like, you know, a webcam, setting your MacBook up, setting something up just to kind of showcase what's going on. People are not necessarily going to judge your project based on the high quality of the video, but they are going to judge what you're showing. So having a video is extremely important here. Number two is not providing any updates. This is a really interesting one to me because the updates kind of change based on the category on Kickstarter. So for example, in the music category, it's totally okay for creators to update like every other day, but in games, you do have to update every other day. So that doesn't necessarily mean that you need to have like long sort of winded responses to things, you know, beautiful images and graphics and things like that. That's definitely not the case. You can do something as straightforward as, we launched today, we're so excited. Hey, we're 35% funded, that's fantastic. Hey, we're funded, yay, we did it. So this is why we typically recommend having the first couple of updates ready to go, but also understanding that there might be, and most likely there will be, a little bit of tailoring that needs to happen just sort of based on the needs of your community. So if you're seeing a lot of people are saying, I don't really understand what the gameplay of this is, take one of those updates, tailor it so you can explain that a little bit more. Bad launch day. So what do I mean by this? So there's two sort of big things. One, launching on a Friday, a Saturday, or a Sunday. I understand why people want to launch on the weekend, but the simple fact is people are not really plugged into Kickstarter on the weekends, right? People are with their families, and I understand too that, you know, we're all sort of stuck at home, but people are like playing games, they're hanging out with their family, they're hanging out with their roommates. Here in New York, for example, phase four has happened, so people are outside a little bit more. I can confirm that because I walk to Prospect Park pretty frequently, and there are just hordes of people. So in addition to having a bad launch day, which is the actual day that you launch, also holidays. So any major US holiday you absolutely want to avoid. That includes like things like President's Day, Martin Luther King Day, any day that you will most likely have the day off, Labor Day, Memorial Day, things like that. Also try, like, you deeply want to avoid launching over any sort of like big holiday towards the end of the year, right? So we would basically say the last time that you should launch your project is roughly mid-October. There's a very big sort of exception to the rule there, which we will talk about. But in general, especially if you're a first-time creator, try to avoid that holiday season. Stretch goals. So launching with visible stretch goals. This is a big no. Stretch goals are kind of overused and used in a way that can be really detrimental to the project. Stretch goals tend to be used as a way to sort of entice people to spend more money, but the reality is your project should really be about the sort of just baseline project that you're presenting. If people want to give you more money and you're willing and excited and able to provide more content based on, you know, getting a little bit more money, that's totally fine. But keep in mind, number one, you're not required to have stretch goals. Stretch goals are always optional. It should not necessarily be part of your launch plan unless it's something that you've thought about. So what I mean by that is, if you're thinking, wow, it'd be so great to add another level, or, you know, there's this one character that I've always thought about adding to this game, but I just don't think financially I can do it, that is a great stretch goal. Things like going to conferences and dressing up as a giant baby are a bad stretch goal. The stretch goal should really just sort of be specifically about the project. And lastly, a thing I just want to say about stretch goals, specifically for video games that I see more often than I'm pleased to. If you have a stretch goal that's for a console version of your game, and you have not had a conversation with Nintendo, Sony, or Microsoft, please do not put that as a stretch goal. You need to have those conversations because ports inevitably cost a lot more than what you think they're going to be. Great, moving on to press reliance. So press reliance here also includes things like streamers, YouTubers, influencers. If anybody can define what an influencer is, I will happily sit down and listen to you because I do not understand it. But the reality is, we at Kickstarter by no means are saying don't get press, don't have streamers, you know, play your game or anything like that. Yeah, absolutely make sure that happens. However, please understand that the reality of, you know, a YouTuber playing your game doesn't necessarily mean that's going to translate to a large number of pledges. It's great for when the game is out because you've built that relationship. You've sort of said like, hey, this streamer really believes in me. This is fantastic. I'm excited about this. But relying on press to bring in your community is a very, very slippery slope. And lastly, just to kind of reiterate here, ghosting, right? Like, make sure that you're talking to your community. It's extremely important. So the number one question that I get asked on Kickstarter, how do I get featured? So there's a couple of things here. We are in close contact with a team here who sort of manages all of the features and the promotions on Kickstarter. We, as the outreach team, so each category for the most part has like a category specialist. We're here to advocate for you. We want to, you know, we want to talk to you. We want to know what's going on. We want to hear your story. We want to be excited for you and with you. So while we don't necessarily manage all the features, we are able to kind of say, hey, we believe in this project. This really should be featured. So what is it that team really looks for? So sort of similar to what I said in some of the yeses, having a strong project image, right? That includes not having any sort of badges or an unnecessary text or anything like that. A project that really showcases what the game is about. Gameplay gifts. Gameplay gifts are a really easy way to just kind of show, like, this is my project, this is what I'm doing, this is what I'm excited about. Talking to us as the outreach team early and often, there are three of us on the games outreach team specifically, myself, our senior tabletop person, John Van Roderick, and our German consultant, who's based in Berlin, who also manages all of Europe. So he's not just German or German consultant, he's your European consultant, Michael Lieb. So if you reach out to us at any point, we are more than happy to talk to you. And I'll have our contact information at the end. And lastly, the games newsletter. So the games newsletter is a newsletter that goes out every other Friday, and we do our best to feature three projects in each category. It's all hand curated. Everything is very it's very well thought out, and it reaches about 180,000 people, which is really cool. So the more that you talk to us and the more that we're able to have those conversations, the more that we're able to advocate for you and possibly get you into these like different sort of avenues. So we have all this information. We've looked at the numbers. We've done our yeses and our nos. Let's look at a couple projects, and I specifically picked projects that were based in New York to just kind of see what it looks like in play. So the first project I want to talk about is actually a project out of Brooklyn called Wavelength. It's described as a, quote, telepathic party game from the creators of The Mind and Monikers. This is actually the sixth successful project from this team, and it's actually their first non-Monikers-related project, which is interesting for a couple of different reasons. One, this is their most funded project to date, despite monikers being kind of what they're most known for. And part of the reason it's so successful is, one, it's a great game, right? Like, having a great game is kind of key here. But two, they've built that trust within the community. So the Keep Kind Me Kickstarter, people that back their projects say, great, awesome, we believe in you. We know that you have a good track record. We're excited to, you know, be a part of this. And so, very, very successful, right? Funded on March 8th of last year. So like a year and 4 months ago, they actually just launched a new project. I believe today is July 22nd. Yes. I think it's called Fuzzies. So they raised $324,355, which is fantastic. They have a very, very, very large number of backers, which is also great. And also keeping in mind that they're an extremely small team. It's like Alex and a couple of his friends. They've done an incredible job. So I wanted to put this graph in here just to kind of show a couple things. One, if you look at this line graph, you can see that there's a bit of a curve that kind of plateaus and then goes up, right? So the thing to keep in mind is that the first couple of days of any project, you're probably going to see a huge spike in pledges, right? And if you look at the first couple of days, they tend to mirror the last couple of days. And this is why we tell people that you should not cancel your project. You genuinely just kind of don't really know what's going to happen. But this line graph pretty much represents every single Kickstarter project. It might have a couple, you know, bumps in the road, but this is pretty typical of what a Kickstarter project looks like. And lastly, if we look at this pie chart here, which is extremely interesting and gives us a ton of information, I'd said there's a 30-70 split for first-time creators, right? And so what we see with these three colors, that orange represents any sort of pledges that are brought in externally, that purpley color is any sort of referral tags, so any sort of like Facebook ads, Twitter ads, things like that, mailing lists, what have you. And that green part are things that are pledged from Kickstarter. And you might say, but you said that 70% of your pledges are going to come in through the community. This is only 24%. The caveat here, which we will see in other projects, is that the more that you run projects, the more likely it is that you're going to fund, and the more the faster it is that you end up funding. What we think is happening here, and what we're pretty sure, is that when you continue to run projects on Kickstarter, you end up building a community on Kickstarter. So your backers will get an email that says, hey, by the way, this creator now has a new project. And so people will immediately go to the project and kind of check it out. So that's partially why the numbers are a little bit different. However, so let's look at a video game, right? So this is Fiction Sphere. This is actually a first-time creator on the platform, and this is their second attempt at funding this project. Their first attempt was in 2017, and it didn't fund, which is totally fine, because there's no such thing as failure on Kickstarter. It's just projects that don't fund. You can always come back and relaunch. It's not like you get a scarlet letter or anything like that. And just to give you a little bit of information about this project, it's described as a 2D technical platformer adventure. It's a love letter to the 90s style video games. Again, this is based out of Brooklyn, which is really, really cool. So their second time around, they raised $28,000 and almost 600 backers. I would also just kind of point out, and they funded in August of last year, but I would just point out, PAX East every year, we have a Kickstarter room, and we do our best to feature a wide variety of games and different types of creators. And I reached out to them and I said, I would love to have you in the room. And they ended up coming, and the reception that they got from PAX East was incredible. So being able to showcase the game in the room, I have no doubt that when the game is out, they're probably going to get like a significant boost in sales, which is really, really cool. But one of the things I really wanted to show here was this graph, which is wild. There's so much happening. So again, this is why we tell people to wait that full 30 days, right? While this does kind of mirror what happened at Wavelength, there's a couple different jumps here. We're not exactly sure what happened going from that sort of like between August 5th and August 11th. So we suspect the game got some traction on Twitter, and that's what ended up causing this giant spike, like, you know, roughly 3/4 of the way through their campaign. So this, again, is very, very close to kind of what we're seeing with that 30-70 split. About 65% comes in through external referrers, so Twitter, Facebook, mailing lists, things like that. And roughly 30 to 34% comes in through Kickstarter. So this is not an uncommon sort of thing that we see from first-time creators, which is really exciting. So they did a great job, and we're really proud of them. The third project and the second to last project that I wanted to look at was Abs versus the Blood Queen. This is a spooky 2D side-scrolling adventure set in the Killer Queen universe. And while Killer Queen was actually not a Kickstarter project, they did end up coming to Kickstarter for their newest game. And we actually kind of love to see that, right? If you have proven success somewhere else and then come and say, but I want to do my next thing on Kickstarter. Like, that's awesome. We get really excited about that. So this actually funded earlier this year in March, like right as lockdown was kind of coming down. So over $47,000 raised, 544 backers, right? From Bumble Bear Games. And I'm very curious about a couple of things here. So if we just kind of quickly move on to their graph. I don't know. Oh, I'm sorry. It shouldn't have been March. It should have been May of this year. I don't 100% know, like, how much COVID has impacted this project, right? So we could see there's a huge spike at the beginning. And like April, May is when things got really bad. So we sort of suspect COVID may have had a little bit at play here, but at the same time, they did an incredible job, right? They had a huge community that they were able to bring in. And again, this is why we tell people, do not cancel your project. I don't know if COVID necessarily would have brought in so many pledges that it would have been like, you know, this just hugely, you know, million-dollar project by any means. But I do think that they are a good kind of case to watch where it showcases how important it is to build a community before you come to Kickstarter, because you kind of never know what's going to happen. And lastly, we obviously have to talk about Kingdom Death. So this is actually their fourth project that they launched, but they only have three successful projects. So one of their projects was a mobile app that for Kingdom Death that I think it just didn't fund, which is totally okay. Like, it's fine. So the first Kingdom Death made $2 million with 5,400 backers, and they actually did that in 2013, which is extremely impressive considering that, like, Kickstarter was definitely on the map, but it's not what it is today for tabletop games. I also want to note that they're based out of Queens, which is really cool. Queens is, I think, an unsung borough. I recently moved from Queens to Brooklyn, and Queens is an amazing place, so shout out to Queens. And so up until Frosthaven, which actually funded this year, this was the most backed games project of all time, and it also was the most funded games project of all time. So it's kind of cool that, you know, we get to see that happen in real time. So obviously this did extremely well. They funded in January of 2017, $12 million raised. They went from almost 5,500 backers to over 19,000 backers. But if you remember when I talked about some of the no's, I said don't launch over the holidays, right? They launched over the Thanksgiving holiday. This project was live during Christmas of 2016, and they still raised $12 million. So this is one of the very, very few exceptions to the rules that we say, you know, just in terms of like avoiding a launch day that might be a little bit problematic because of the community that they already had. Once you have that community, they're willing to kind of follow you and, you know, just kind of like be on this journey with you a bit. As you can see here, right, they funded pretty much immediately. And similar to what we saw with Wavelength, a lot of these pledges are sort of based on the community that they exist, that they brought in through Kickstarter. But again, all these graphs, for the most part, kind of have the same sort of trajectory in terms of the line graph. And so I'd sort of mention this really quickly, but what if I fail on Kickstarter? I get this question a lot too. I don't think there's anything that is actually a failed Kickstarter project. I've seen so many things happen where project didn't fund, but then a publisher came in and took on the project. You know, as we saw with Fiction Sphere, the game relaunched and they ended up being successful. That also happened this year with a game called Aquamarine, where they took a little bit of time and said, hey, let's reassess. Relaunched, funded, awesome, fantastic. The most important thing here is that you can relaunch. I understand having what feels like a little bit of a, like, sort of mark against you, but I can promise you it's totally fine. So if there's anything I can leave you with, build a community early and often, show your gameplay, keep your video short, you do not need to fund on day one, and please come talk to us. And so this is how you can get in touch with us. You can email me personally at anya@kickstarter.com. Or you can email our games email, which is games@kickstarter.com. We have a couple people checking that email address, so you will hear from me or one of the other people on the games team. So thanks to Dan and everyone at PlayNYC again for having me. This was wonderful, and I hope you enjoy the rest of the conference.